jobs. Some complex, some easy. We're gonna be, each one gets laid out separately, of course. We're gonna try to do some of the, some detail work on coming up with some real sharp looking lettering, some concourse winning lettering if possible. And we have everything here from the most simple, the most basic to, which I guess would be Bobby Barron's LJ, to some really complex, very fancy lettering. This, of course, is the two sweepers, the two big guys there. Again, both of them very, very intricate lettering patterns. And remember, this is always choice one. This is one of the choices you always have. That's the lettering on the whole plane. It's a real time, saver. See, good thing I don't know whose plane that is, or they'll be mad at me for saying it. But anyway, one of the choices you obviously have in wall lettering is no lettering at all, or decals. Looks like there's a decal here, yeah. You have Bob Gieske's lettering here. Now it's like a USA on one wing, a number on the other wing. Not outlined, kind of simple, tidy. Since he's the world champion, we'll have to show him the proper respect. Here's Peter Zwada's model from Poland. You really can't see it in a picture, but it does have kind of a nice lettering job on it. Frank Williams, this was his exotic side mount on that side. 84 Nats, Reno. Again, very simple lettering. You can see out here it's just some 1-inch decals. A lot of choices when it comes to lettering. One of Stan Powell's doves. Again, nice intricate lettering, neat, business-like. Kind of a stiletto-looking guy. You can hardly see the lettering. It's very small here. Don Hofelder's plane, nice, neat lettering. And Billy Simons used to do some of his lettering this way, front to back, top to bottom, whatever you want to call it. That isn't Billy Simons' plane, but that's another choice you have. The old smoothie that's in the same album. And here's one of my my really favorite pictures of all time of Marty Ciccola, 1983 Nats. You can see the ship up here going through his either his outside maneuvers or whatever. Just love this picture. I wish I had the negative. I wish I could make an enlargement of it. But anyway, with no further ado, let's get the tape off the plane. Let's get the lettering books out. Let's get our fingers cleaned with alcohol. Let's get drunk. Let's do up some Snapple, whatever. Call Midgley on the phone, holler at him, get Big Jim excited. Who knows what we're doing today, but whatever comes our way, we're ready to do it. Now off to the shop. Okay, one of the things I want to give some thought to now, we're actually ready to put the tape on the plane. I want to lay out the lettering. And there's several choices I have for lettering. I'd like to run through what some of the options you have. Now, one of the things you don't have an option about, you have an option of putting the name on, and typically this goes on the inboard wing, and most people try to balance it off with the AMA number. The rules say it must be 1 inch high, and it must be legible. So a lot of thought should go into laying this out in a pleasing way, a way that makes sense, a way that looks like it's balanced. And here's just some of the thoughts, some of the things to avoid, and in the course of doing this. And I'm assuming everybody is going to have a name for their plane. Let's say the name is the Raven, and AMA 753. Let's just make a pretend up. Okay. Some of the things I like to consider and think of is when I lay out the lettering job, first off, I'm looking for balance. I don't want to have this be and then the AMA number over here. So one thing is a balanced, both sides to be kind of roughly equal. Now another thing I try to avoid, and I've run into this in other planes, is a name for the plane. where the name is like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, like the arowana, for instance. And then the AMA number is, well, I don't like that either. Now, these are personal choice things. I understand you're not going to be downgraded on this. But since we're talking about making an aesthetically pleasing plane and all of the things that will contribute to that, I think the best choice would be if you laid out your lettering, and let's say, in the case of this airplane, the name is the Cardinal. Now I lay out the AMA number, and my number is 72618. I see, oh, three too many. So the space will count as one, and I'll put the N number. That's for international competition. That's the N that represents the United States. Now it's a little more of a balanced presentation that I'd be inclined to like this a lot more than hi, my name is Freddie, the name of the airplane, and AMA 12618. So these are just a few things to consider before you go laying out the lettering. Okay, now there's several ways to do lettering. Letra sets. We're going to discuss letra sets in a future, I guess two or three tapes down the road, we'll be doing letra sets and ink lines. Letra sets are one easy way to do this. Now, I have a set of Tom Lay letra sets here, and I would suggest if it fits into the style you like that you try to use these letra sets. They are an inch high, they are legal, and you get, you know, all these little no steps and no oil and water and everything to decorate the plane. When it comes time to do this, you want to try to use these wherever there's a bad spot in a plane to detract from the little ding or dong or whatever, kind of help you hide the bad spots. You want to try to use a variety of lettering. I don't like seeing a plane where all lettering is exactly the same. But you do get, and this is the point we want to make, we do get a balanced set of AMA numbers and AMA, so you can kind of balance it out in a lot of different ways. You can kind of get a look that makes sense. It doesn't have the decal look. Okay, but supposing you choose not to do letra sets. You want to do paint. Now, Steve Busso has come up with many nice ways of making a mask or a cover, and that typically is a sheet of 3M paper, and in it he razors out. This has been documented in flying models. He cuts out the letters in such a way, it's real nice. Then you peel out the letters. You put wax paper underneath. By the way, this is on one of the Stunt Forum videos. I try to remember which one. I think the 91. He showed this in detail. You lay this in place, slide out the wax paper, and press it down. This is contact paper. But what you need to do this in any way that makes sense, you need to know the style of lettering. And when you pick a style, it's usually called a font. I don't know if that's how they spell it, but it's called a font anyway. What you need to do is you go to a letra set catalog, or you buy a set of letra sets, and let's just say the name is that you're going to use is Cardinal, just for the sake. Okay, here you have the word Cardinal. Now, this is not 1 inch high. This maybe is only a quarter inch or a half inch. You can do this any size. What you do is lay it out on a sheet of paper, normal copying paper, lay the thing out, and then take it over and photo enlarge it. Now, photo enlarge you can do at Staples. Most libraries have a good copier. You put in a piece of 8.5 by 11 paper, and it comes out being, I think, 11 by 14. And so now the word Cardinal is twice as big, or much bigger. Then you can also take this off and make it 4 times as big until you have, even if you have to do one letter at a time, typically, of course, a nickel a pop, but you can wind up with, now, when you lay out that wing, you can lay out the words in this size, this size, this size, and you can lay it out in capitals, some bigger than, say you wanted to, some bigger, you wanted a capital C, you could photo enlarge that up bigger, but the fonts would all match. You would have a matching font. So this is just some of the ways to make a mask and make a Steve Busso kind of very nice, fancy lettering job. Now, the lettering method I like to do, I outline the letters in 1/8-inch tape, and I'm going to show the method of doing this. And so each letter would have, in effect, an 1/8-inch outline. And I'll show how I'm going to airbrush or paint this area in and then mask it off when I paint the whole airplane. So that even underneath the lettering job, there's no double paint. Now, one of the things you have to do when you lay this out, and let's just do one wing panel at a time, you have to know the physical space you have available. When you determine, and I'll just do my deal here, full size or whatever. What you have to realize, you have to, in your mind, block out a space, leave a little border. I like to leave about a quarter of an inch, a quarter of an inch, a quarter of an inch. And let's say that's the space available. When I refer to space available, it means this is the amount of space we have to fill with lettering. Now, when we do it in the method I'm going to show, you don't need to have any photo enlarging, you don't need to have any letter sets, you don't need anything actually, and you can be very creative in how you formulate up the lettering. And just to walk through it once, let's pretend this is a wing panel, and I want to kind of make this as close to being what we're actually going to use as possible, so you can see what the theory is. I purposely kept this dimension here and this dimension here when I laid out the trim equal, so that the letters don't get bigger or smaller. The letters remain a constant size. That's not necessary, because if you use this method, you can make the letters appear like they're three-dimensional. Glenn Medder did a great job of doing what's called disappearing line, disappearing point. Disappearing point means you have to have a big drafting table and you set a point here and draw imaginary lines up this way, and then you put a point over here and you draw lines this way, and then Superman, the movie Superman, does this, and then you make your lettering based on disappearing points. I think the name of his plane was Eagle, but comes out very sexy looking, very nice, but it's all of these lines go into a disappearing point. It's called disappearing point. And Glenn, of course, had a front row plane, a beautiful plane with that type of lettering. But rather than doing that, I'm going to be doing a method where I'm going to put an imaginary tape border out here, and I'm going to work within this box. Then I'm going to decide on the thickness of my lettering, and I'm going to cut a strip with a couple little holes in it with masking tape so I can use a pattern. And I'm going to lay out in 1/8-inch tape inside the box. I'm going to lay out each box for each letter. And then within each box, I'll have a tape box. Within each box, I'm going to lay out the lettering in 1/8-inch tape using this as a thickness guide, so that the whole letter will be that thickness. Now, this seems, if you've never done this before, you might be thinking, oh my God, this is a lot of work. This is a lot of high-tech stuff. This is really easy. The first time you see this done, and you walk through it, and you say, oh well, I looked at so-and-so's lettering job and oh my God, awesome, yeah? But when you see how easy this is, you're gonna see, once you pick a font, pick a style. Now, another thing we could do if we wanted to, in the space available, look, I did last year. Last year's plane, all the letters lean to one side like that. Now, if you notice this lettering, it's all on an angle, and then it reverses the angle on the other side, so it all comes up to almost like a disappearing point, somewhere where all the trim in the plane radiates from one point. Now, another thing, when you consider any trim on the airplane, this is just a gut feeling of mine, the trim on the airplane, what it's supposed to do is impart motion. And if you look at this, it's like everything was sweeping from one focal point here. Or like a Juno radiates all its little points off of a central point in the fuselage. All of these little things, they all contribute to the overall impact of a plane. It sits down there on the rows, the judges go by, and something catches their eye. In this case, this lettering was not that difficult to do, but it did, I'm sure it contributed a major part toward getting a Concours award. Now, a couple more final thoughts. When you're doing this type of lettering, now there's a very easy way to get this kind of lettering, and it is go out and buy a case of beer and cut out the lettering and go to a photo enlarging machine and just make a copy the size you need, and it'll be an exact replica of the lettering that was on the box. Then you can make that mask up a la Steve Busso. No sense going into too much detail there, because he's done that on a Stunt Forum video, how to do the masks, and then you get a very accurate, like this looks just like the beer can or whatever this is supposed to look like the semi-scale plane. Now, almost every time I do a lettering job, there's a couple of basic rules I follow. One of them is, this assumes you're going to have lettering on the bottom. If you're not, you know, you go right into the top. But the trick here is you lay out all your lettering on the bottom, because you may see on the bottom, and I guess a typical example is when you're all done, you may think, oh, gee, if I just put that little thing there, and if I just did this, and I just did that, and I just did this, and then what you can do is change the top. And nobody will notice that these little things or little changes are made not on the bottom. But it's always good to get in the rhythm, get in the mood, or whatever you want to call it. Practice is a good word, or make your mistakes. Always do the bottom first. Whenever you spray a plane, always start by spraying the bottom first. Whenever you sand a plane, it's a good idea if you're not really sure. Sand the bottom first, because you'll always notice that 10 or 15 minutes or a half hour into a job, you're getting a little feel, you're getting a little bit better, you're getting a feel for the material, for how it's sanding, how it's painting, whatever. And by the time you flip it over and do the top, it should be perfect. Or as close to perfect as you really can expect. This is something I really don't like to see on a plane. It's my personal taste. I understand there are reasons people use decals, RC people, or whatever. I don't like any decals. Decals, I don't know, somehow cheapen up a beautiful plane. You see a beautiful Concorde plane, and right on the top of it is a decal. And wherever the lettering ends, you can see that line around the decals. I don't know. I'm not crazy about decals. I would eliminate decals out of the program, number one. Another thought, Letraset's. There's a Letraset catalog you can buy or borrow or go to an art supply store. Art supply store. Look through this catalog. There's about 210 fonts. Before you pick out a font, there's thousands of sizes. And you can pretty much, if you're going to do a Letraset job and you don't want to use the Tom Lay Letrasets, a couple of things about Letrasets. Make sure they're fresh. Go to an art supply store that has a tremendous turnover. Don't go to some little hole in the wall place in Podunk, because the stuff's going to be on the shelf. Anything over a year old, soon as these Letrasets get a year old, you don't know whether they're worth saving, using. I've used them, I've used old ones, but then half of the time you wind up putting big dents in a plane trying to make them stick. Fresh is the ticket if you're going to do Letraset lettering. And here's a typical lettering job that probably took about an hour. The word Cardinal and the word 20-pointer when I refinished a Cardinal. Very easy to do, simple. Piece of cake. If this is the type of lettering you want to do, certainly no reason I can think of not to do that. Some of the other planes that I've had that have had that kind of lettering, you know, you can get as exotic as this, and it doesn't get any more exotic than that. You're looking at a month of hand artwork there, and hand taping and airbrushing and whatever, making patterns, making photo enlargements. Mike Haravich must have spent $100 in making photocopies of different size lettering before I actually laid that out. And I laid these numbers and fives and everything right off of the real pictures of the real airplane. Now that's just one final thought, and then we're going to start laying tape. One final thought is, this is a picture of the real Red Baron when it, before it crashed, you know, and was destroyed for all time forever. You can get pictures from Scale Research of a real plane. Let's say you want to do a lettering job similar to the Red Baron. Well, you can go get the Scale Research photos and do the photo enlargement up or down to make your mat. Or you can do what I did. I had Mike photo enlarge them up in several sizes, and then I pretty much laid out all these little lines in freehand. All this stuff was freehand. Freehand everything all along the wing until I got to a point that I was happy with it. And when you're talking about lettering, it pays to take a little time, because the lettering on the wing is going to set the plane apart from the crowd to a big degree.
Dave Midgley's lettering job. A lot of time and effort and thought went into that lettering job, I'm sure.
This is Russ Hunsberger's lettering job. Now, Russ had a guy cut these stencils out. They advertise in a machine, in the model airplane news, a place that'll cut the lettering to your size, your font, and with the angle. Notice the angle goes up, the angle goes in. They all go to an imaginary disappearing point at the spinner. He had these cut, they're press-on, they worked out real well. Joe Adamusco laid these out with a mask. This is all done with a mask. Another totally professional job. Just to give you some ideas, give you some inspiration. If you're going to build a plane and you're going to spend all winter, why not have it the best it possibly can be? Why compromise it in some way by putting the lettering on with a crayon or whatever?
There's two nice lettering jobs there, boy. If that isn't a pile of workmanship right there, I don't know what is. Joe Adamusco from Newton, Pennsylvania, one of the top builders in the world. And if you look real close, you'll see this is not the Red Baron. This is a plane that was built with a nobler wing. And it's like a little kind of a mini Red Baron. It's a 35 size ship. And it doesn't have the cuff on a wing, but he did this lettering all freehand. And you can see he did a pretty nice job, pretty good copy of the lettering job. Now one more final point here before we move on. I've always liked this type of lettering where it's kind of a freehand. I think he did this all by eye, I'm not sure. But it's really a sexy kind of lettering, and it does not look like it came off a Letraset sheet. And he, like I do, I put the little cardinal on this wing, he made the cobra snake out on the other wing. Now, doing that is not as difficult as it might seem. If you think about it, sketching a little pattern of this out, there's a lot of nice little ways you can do it. This is another one of those freehand jobs. This was just all done freehand to try to match the Red Baron, kind of. And then I had Mike make me photocopies a little bit bigger and a little bit smaller until I got the balance that I wanted. Another thing here you can see on Bill Rich's plane, he made the letters like three different colors or two different colors, just airbrushed them in after the mask is on a plane. That's another nice little nice touch. This is Ray Moore with one of the planes he made, kind of like a Jimmy Casale plane, and you'll notice the lettering's all different colors. I was never crazy about this paint job, it just looked too busy. It looked too much like something from Toys R Us, but that is another choice that you can make the mask in and fade the different colors in. Here's a plane by Fred Tellier, and the reason I'm showing this is I wanted to give you an idea about it. Now he has used a little maple leaf. I guess that's the sign of Canada or the country or town or whatever that he comes from. Snowbird, and he has this little pattern that repeats itself. Well, this is real easy to do. What he's done is made up a little pattern, or actually used the leaf itself to go make a photocopy of, and then make a mask. Another way to do this is to take ordinary copying paper. Let's say you wanted to do this emblem, okay? You can take ordinary copying paper that you would come in a Xerox machine, go and photocopy that leaf, and that will make a pattern of that leaf. Then razor it out with a brand new razor, and you'll have this pull that little piece out. Okay, how he's done this. Now, while that's out, you lay that on, just rub rubber cement on the whole wing. Put the paper down, let it dry 5 minutes, and then take your finger and rub out all the rubber cement from inside where the leaf would be. And you can go into the corners with your finger if you choose to do this. I just want to mention all these methods. So that you'll have a mask now, and it'll be copying paper. And now you can just get around all the edges, get all the rubber cement. It'll peel right up like chewing gum, believe me. No problem at all. Ordinary rubber cement from an office supply store. Then airbrush in the leaf and go around the edge. So you see, he has a real nice thing. Now the piece that came out, you take a little piece of tape, so you have a handle, so it's on the end of a little handle, and lay it out on a wing and spray the red stripe. Move it, spray the red stripe. Move it, spray the red stripe. As you come down, you'll actually make two patterns for the price of one here. That's one way of doing it. Now here's a couple of planes Dave Midgley. Too bad this isn't in color. These are light blue and green blended together, but we made up a pattern for this star. He made a pattern up. And this is all masked off, made a mask, and then faded in the blue to green here. This is all faded, blue to green, the top block. Then photo enlarge it down and make the tail piece.
not that difficult to do, yet it adds a real custom touch to the plane. This is one of Russ Hunsberger's planes that he did a nice lettering job on. Ted Fancher's plane, notice how he works his name into the paint job. That's a nice little touch. Nice lettering, Letraset photocopies, or they might even be real Letrasets. And then he angled this all off into imaginary point where the spinner would be. Remember that old thing of imparting motion, all the trim imparting motion coming from a point up by the spinner. Now, believe it or not, this is a very, very difficult paint job to do because the whole bottom of the plane is white and the whole top of the plane is red. You have to bottom mask the whole half of the plane. Anyway, the way this was done is I painted the stars gold, painted the base coat of this candy apple with a candy apple silver and a candy apple gold, then masked off the stars, and then painted the whole plane red at once. So the only tape that was on the plane was the outline of the stars, and these stars actually come out two different colors when you go over a different color base coat. Another treatment for a cardinal paint job looks kind of nice. Keith Ferguson's son Michael here, who used to lay out all the lettering for Jimmy Casale's planes. And you can see how nice he's laid out this trim scheme and the lettering, kind of a match thing. A lot of choices here. The idea is be creative. Don't be afraid to try something new. And, you know, don't think, well, the only thing I can do is just put Letrasets on here and that's it. Try something new. Give it a shot. If it doesn't work out, get out the sandpaper and sand it off. You're not committed here to anything. It's not like making something. You can always sand it off, paint the plane silver again, and start again. You're never finished with a lettering job. Now, the only point left I wanted to make was about the doing these little small stencil like that, or a small stencil like this, or if you see on a tail here, this is the only picture I can find, has a little griffin on the tail. I want to give a little idea thought to that too. When you want to put these little stencils and little designs, now in the case of a cardinal, the little insignia is such, and it's no point making it too fancy here. It's kind of like a bird. That's kind of what it looks like, and he's got a kind of like a tough guy look, kind of a I'm mad look. Anyway, boy, he looks sick anyway. But anyway, you can always take a little design, a small design, and work this up. And on the griffin, I had the little griffin. I can't even draw that right now. What I did with the griffin, and he was like a little lion, it had little feet, is I found a Peugeot advertisement, and I photo enlarged it up into the size I wanted, and then made a little mask. In the case of the cardinal, he's kind of a copy of the football cardinals with a very little change. I photo enlarged up a football helmet decal, and then went right out and, you know, kind of made it the size I wanted, and then cut a pattern. In this case, when you're going to do little patterns, you need to make the first pattern is this, let's just say, so you can see how this is done. That's pattern one. Then you mask that over and you make pattern two, and that's, let's say that's his beak. This is pattern two. This would be yellow, and then you mask it off and then paint this black, leave this spot for the eye. You make it up in little sections. It's kind of like a what would be a good way to think about this? Like a color by numbers thing. You just have all the patterns. You take the full pattern, you cut it up into pieces, and then just make, say, here's a sheet of paper. You make in the middle of a sheet of paper all that piece, and the middle of that piece, and just keep changing them. And if you do it with the rubber cement or if you do it with tape, it really doesn't matter. You wind up with a real nice, you know, fancy little emblem. It can be the griffin, the cardinal. Mike Dietrich has the cobra. Midgley was trying to make mirrors one year for his mirror image. Russ likes to have a cat. He's on the bottom of his plane. I've done one of the videos. He's got a cat, Rebecca Lee. That's a nice little touch. It'll add something to the overall appearance of your plane. Now here's the little stencils, decals, whatever you want to call them. I'm sure Bill didn't paint this by hand. But a nice transfer job, and he's got a matching, balancing. Kind of a neat thing, kind of a nice look. And with that, we've talked about it, but the main thing I'm trying to do here, the biggest number one thing I'm trying to do with all this, is to give you some ideas and give you some inspiration. And once you look at how a lot of these things are done, you watch the video, whatever, come up with the idea you want, go out and give it a try. It's not that difficult, and I'm sure you'll really be thrilled with the results when you have something that's very unique, very creative. Workmanship is first class. And when you do, absolutely send me some pictures so we can put your picture on the video here. I only have about 10,000 pictures left. Let's get you on the video. If you need the pictures back, just mark them. Please return too. Okay, today we're back to get ready to do some lettering on this guy. Now we have a choice at this point in time. We can start pulling up the tape here and start doing the white stripe. And we will do that first before we lay out the lettering, just because I don't like to leave the tape on an inordinate long amount of time. We'll pull up that, we'll do that first, and then we're going to get into block. Again, I'm looking around every chance I get, looking for little imperfections to find I can fill in. If I ding it up in the process of working on it, usually ding it up a few times. I've got a little jar of Windex out to keep the tips of my fingers dry and clean. Clean clothes, you don't want to have a shirt on that you just worked on an oil refinery on. You want to try from this point on, keep the plane as clean as possible. Maybe once an hour or so, go wash your hands. My hands are all rotted up from lacquer thinners and whatever. We have all the trim on the bottom, and we're ready to get going. Now I'm come on in. Now, right in the middle of us pulling some masking tape off, we had a visit by Tom Niebuhr, Circle Burner, the oldest member of the Circle Burners.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.
And those are the good things. Anyway, he wants to show on the video his new wheel pants that are available from Tom Niebuhr, exclusively made out of, what is that, polycarbonate?
No, it's a, I guess it's polyethylene.
Yeah, Dave Midgley molds these, and they were off of Tom's mold. These are for his new stunt ship, which we hope we'll get on a video somewhere down the road.
Yeah.
And I guess you'll join these together with what? Some kind of plastic cement?
That's all there is to it, yeah.
Auto primer them, sand them with 320, auto primer them, and paint them similar to a chipmunk cowling. But what's your phone number, Tom?
201-764-7056.
Okay, if anybody's interested in these, give the guy a call. Collect. He says call anytime. No problem.
Yeah, right.
Anyway, we're going to get back to masking this, unmasking it later. We're taking the tape off nice and slow, little by little. And obviously we can do that while Tom's paying us a visit. So if you're interested in the wheel pants or knowing more about it, give Tom a call.
And I'll know a whole lot more about him myself.
Yeah, we'll see him on a completed plane. Now after that little impromptu visit by Tom, Tom's gone now. I want to start peeling off the masking tape. Now, I want to show a couple of little techniques. First off, when you pull off masking tape, we'll start at the back of the body, pick the tip up with a little bit of a razor blade, a point of a razor blade, and pull it off nice and slow. Pull it completely back and pull it slow if you want to try to avoid pulling up the paint. Now, it might have a tendency, if you've cut the corners in with a brand new razor, we'll show this up close if we can. If you've cut the corners with a brand new razor, you have a tendency to pick up the corners. I've started the corners here. You want to pull it straight back. Pulling it this way is no good. It's not a good idea. I like to pull it straight back so it forms a complete 90 degree. Okay, there's a joint in the tape or whatever there. Start another one. Straight back, and the trick is pull it slow. The faster you pull it, the more tension it's going to have on the paint. Get a little corner pulled up, pull it back about an inch. Actually, what I'm doing, I'm pressing my finger right onto the body, so that tape is coming back exactly 90 degrees. That's one of the most common problems of doing a sophisticated paint job, is getting the tape off without pulling up the paint. straight back and nice and slow. And if you see you're pulling up paint, go even slower.
Just takes time. You just can't rush this part. You start rushing it, you wind up pulling paint up.
Now, once you have the tape peeled up, and I like to do one little area at a time, you need a credit card. Hopefully a fresh or a new credit card. If you don't have this, you need some kind of a piece of plastic, like the tools that we use for doing ink lines, the green templates. You can't use a razor blade. I have tried using razor blades. I haven't had any luck. And you can't sand this. Sanding it is just going to make a mess you can't believe. You need to take this and shave it. Go on about a 45 degree angle, and this just knocks off all the little edges. You go one way, and you go the opposite way. You can use all the corners, all the edges. Nice and gentle too. If you press too hard, you're going to put dents in the balsa wood. Now at this point in time, you're not going to get these edges perfect. I don't care how good you are. You're not going to have perfect edges at the end of this part of the job. You just want to knock off all the big stuff so that when you lay the tape down for the white stripe that's going to be in the middle, you won't have to deal with a bunch of rough edges. You're not going to get it perfect at this point in time.
Okay, you see the edges are still a little, not perfect anyway. They're close, but no cigar. So you want to get a little bit of a radius on each edge now, which we just did with the credit card. That's an important thing called shaving. You want to make sure all the points, you don't have a rough edge here. And then I wipe it dry with a clean paper towel before we go on to the next step.
Again, the tools you need a really sharp razor that you can pick the corners of the tape up with. You want to pull the tape back, and you cannot rush this part of it. You start rushing this part. Now, just so you have a concept here, the tissue and the base finish, the substrate, is only going to have a certain amount of bond. It's never going to be any stronger than the balsa wood underneath it, and the punkier and lighter the wood you use, the less and less the bond is. So when you're using real 4-pound wood and you tissue it down with butyrate dope light coat, it only has a certain amount of bond. It doesn't have a bond like steel to brass and when it's brazed. It's only has a certain amount of bond. And you really put this to the test when you use anything but really good fresh masking tape. If you start having a problem and pulling up tape, you know you haven't put enough thinner in the base coats of the paint, number one. Number two, you can take the tape in an emergency and rub it down on the table, pull it up off the table so it's a little less sticky, and then use it from that point on in the finish. You can use it, it's a little less sticky, and you can maybe get through, maybe you can't. I remember Paul Walker had one plane, 89 plane, I think, I don't really remember, and he had problems with the tape pulling up the substrate. And it's a common thing, everybody has it, world champions, national champions, or whoever. It's a thing of, you can stack the deck in your favor by pulling the tape up slowly. You can stack the deck in your favor by never using old tape. Tape has a shelf life. It gets stickier and stickier as time goes by. What you should do is buy tape and within a month or so try to use it up. Don't try to inventory it and stock it for years and years to come. Buy the amount. Now this amount of striping that's on the plane right now, we've used a roll and about an eighth. So I'm thinking this amount of trim, you might need 3 rolls to do the whole plane plus the lettering. But you don't want to inventory tape. You don't want to buy 100 rolls. 2 years later, the tape will not be usable. 2 years, 3 years. I don't know what the real shelf life is, but it's not infinite, that's for sure. And you can see, we're not pulling up any of the substrate here. This is really good. This gives us an indication that the substrate on the plane is in good shape, and we'll be able to go right forward with our paint job without making any adjustments right now. Now if we were pulling up substrate right now or having a problem, one of the things we'd consider is making the trim less busy, less intensive, so that there'd be less total tape on the airplane. Or if we did, from this point on,
we'd be looking at taking all the tape that's going to touch the airplane and rubbing it on a t-shirt first, pulling it up off the t-shirt, and using it that way. That's like a lifeboat. That might or might not save you from having to sand off all the substrate. And right now, the thought of sanding off all the substrate is would not make my day complete, that's for sure. So, I'll pull the rest of this off. I want to get the last piece of this off. And I'll spend about maybe 2-3 minutes, maybe 5 minutes on each panel, each section, using the card, shaving it. This is really an important part of doing this. I mean, it's important to lay out the lettering, lay out the trim artistically and tastefully, and whatever image or look you want, whether you want it to look big, bad, and mean, or pretty, or whatever. But it's important to get these tape edges pulled down. Now, it's not going to be perfect now, but even though it isn't perfect, I want to go around, and if I see a little spot here, there, or anywhere, I can touch up now. Well, this would be a good time. Touching it up is an ongoing thing. See, if you hold a card parallel, it kind of catches. If you use it on a 45 degree angle, and then 45 degree angle back, and don't press too hard. Very light. The trick here is very light strokes. Another thing too, if you're doing this and you see, for instance, the green stripe or the orange stripe starting to peel up, you can take a little bit of clear dope. I haven't had one come up yet, so a little bit of clear dope underneath and just kind of bend it back down and then touch it up so you don't lose that chunk. You don't have a little moon crater right in the middle of everything. So far we haven't run into that problem, but there's no telling that we would. People in the store never can understand why my Visa card has such nice rounded edges. I always tell them it's because Karen uses it too much. Okay, that's really one panel. I'd give this a little look around. Here's a little spot sticking up over here I can kind of peel out. It's an ongoing thing. Keep after it. A little spot here. Bit of paint crept under the tape. Okay, we have all the tape off, even around the canopy. We've gone around the plane, done a few little touch-ups that needed to be done, and I've wiped the whole plane down with a clean paper towel prior to starting this white, because white is going to pick up every little speck of dust, everything, dandruff, whatever you have. Get rid of it, get everything immaculately clean. We'll start on one wing panel, it really doesn't matter which one, and we're going to try to lay out now that eighth-inch stripe in white. Now here's another good trick. You take a used roll of paper towels, this is it, not a big deal, but it certainly makes it easier, and shove it under the wing that's low so it isn't rocking back and forth while you're working on it. That makes it a little easier to get the work done on it. Every little tip helps, believe me. Now here's where it comes in handy. We have all the jaws sitting here from the days before. We're ready to go right into paint. As soon as we get the tape laid out, everything's ready to go. We're not sitting here wondering, are we going to open this up, close this, open this, whatever. We're always ready to go, because this trim job takes basically maybe 3-4 days, maybe a week. And for that amount of time, if the thinner evaporates out of the paint, just put a few drops more in there. Now I'm laying out the tape stripes here, and of course it's a very fine detail. The whole trick is now to try to get the tape to ride right along the edge. Don't leave a lot of the edge sticking out, and don't skip a spot. Try to get the tape right up on the edge. And again, this takes a little practice. Another this is another great time to break out some new surgical blades and get the corners nice and clean. All this stuff will contribute to a better job, that's for sure. Press it down as you go. What we're trying to do is leave this spot right in the center of the two stripes where it's going to be white. Now we're going to seal it with clear again, similar to what we did on a previous video. If you haven't seen the previous video, you definitely want to watch that one first. You don't have to be fussy about inside corners here. You can just go right down. But you certainly do want to be real accurate about getting it right up on the edge. Right up on the edge and not over by any amount. This definitely does take a little practice too. This is called backmasking when you're going over paint that's already been painted. And we'll just do one of these stripes on camera. And we'll go and do the rest of them off camera. Thing I'm trying to emphasize here is you can't rush through this. You can't rush through in a half an hour and just slap this stuff on. This stuff really does take a little time. Because now the white paint is going to build up to the same height, hopefully. If you do it in three coats, if you do the three coat method, it builds up to the same height and you don't have a mountaintop. You have two equal plateaus, they kind of blend together, and you don't have that chunk, 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 and then you have to fill it all in with clear and sand it and everything. The idea is we want to wind up with a plane that the whole plane has an equal coat of colored paint on it. We don't have one with three coats and one area with four coats and five coats and mountains and valleys and peaks, and we want to have it all equal if possible. That's what we'd be trying to accomplish anyway. I just had a little spot here where the tape is lifting up. Okay, I'll show this up close. Now you can see we have the green stripe and the orange stripe covered. We'll run our finger right down. Toward the end, we get where it spreads wide. We want to get a nice point there. Get all the corners in nice. See, now in this case, we can leave the tape and just hanging off. In here, it just can hang off. It doesn't have to be neat. The only thing we need is the little, let's call it a ditch for now. And let's go paint the edge with clear first and then white. Okay, that's the first coat of white. We're going to use the three coat method that I described in the previous video. And we'll do the other panels now off camera. And we'll come back to this roughly once an hour or so, or half hour, depending on how quick this dries up, and put a second coat of white on it. We got the last of the white stripes on the bottom going on right now. And probably we will not be able to start this lettering until tomorrow. Got an awful lot of mail today, awful lot of work, so we're going to try to stock up on that, get that out the door today. And we'll pick up on taping off the lettering tomorrow. Now, one of the points I want to bring up, and this is a real important point, is when you start this, you want to let this tape stay on overnight now. Now even if we did start the lettering right now, I don't want to pull the tape up until it sits on the airplane overnight. Whenever you do dope or lacquer, you want the plane to sit overnight. When you do epoxy, you want to get the tape off as soon as possible. That's the general rule of thumb here when it comes to tape striping. Now I got the clear on this side. one coat of white on that side, two coats there, three coats here. Before I finish this out, I'll make sure I have three coats on everything, get the third coat on, and then put this puppy away for the day. Okay, the last step here before we actually go into the lettering. Last step on this guy. Gonna be the orange around the canopy. I've already given this a coat of clear. We have all the white striping done now. And we'll give this the three coats. And we'll be ready to start the lettering. Now we tape it up right in the front of the canopy. We tape it up in a similar way where the stripe got a little bit wider out at the point, so it makes like an arrowhead of a point right up in the tip. Now the canopy, because it's going to be green, will have the same stripe pattern. The canopy will be green, it'll only be a white and an orange stripe, and the orange will border the purple, just like on our drawing. Well, tomorrow morning we'll set up and start the lettering. That is definitely it. All the striping's on now. And we don't want to pull any of the tape off for, let it sit at least 24 hours. Okay, tonight we're back from the shop, ready to do another all-night session. Now, we have all the striping on, and I guess you can see we got the orange around the canopy. We put that on before we went down the shop. Got the three coats, got the three coats on all the white. What I do is just monitoring this, looking around. I'm going to leave the tape on until tomorrow morning. Just looking for any spot, and I'll spend a little time looking for any spot I might have missed, any spot where the paint didn't come out nice and opaque. In fact, I do see a spot on the bottom. And this is always a problem when you walk away from something for a few hours and you get back to it. What you usually find out is a spot you missed the first time around. Yeah, one spot back here. I really should make it a little darker. Anyway, this is what you're gonna find. Look at this little dog. I'm babysitting this dog and he won't leave me alone. I'm gonna tape him. The guy weighs 2.5 pounds. I put him on a gram scale. Unbelievable. Jetson is his name. Anyway, come on, Jetson, out of the way. Anyway, what you see is there's a few spots on here, and this is a typical thing. Even though it has three coats, and even though it's dried for about 6 hours now, it's really not solid. So we're gonna put a little thinner in the paint and give that a fourth coat. What I'm trying to say not to do is don't give it a full strength coat. Even if it's a little opaque, a little translucent after three coats, when you put the fourth coat on, it tends to build up too much thickness. So I'll put a little extra thinner in the paint and give that a fourth coat, and then we're going to start the lettering. You believe this is a dog? Come on, Jetson, get out of here. Now, I just put about a 20% extra 3608S thinner in here. So I'm trying absolutely not to build up these paint thicknesses more than three coats. Three brushed on coats is about the max you can get away with. Now the only problem is while I was down the shop today, I did get good and dirty and greasy, so I'm going to really have to be careful. This is another tip. If you do the kind of work that say if you're a car mechanic or whatever and you tend to get a lot of grease and oil on your hands, and then you try to do this kind of work, put double the amount of fisheye killer in the paint. Now, I'm lucky so far. I don't have any fisheye problems on this, but this is about the time you start seeing fisheyes in the paint. You go for the color paint or somewhere around now, you start seeing fisheyes, then you know you're going to have a problem. You know you've taken the silicone and the grease from your hands and gotten it down into the paint. Okay, we're not going to take the tape off till tomorrow morning. We're going to try to press on with this lettering. I don't know how many hours I'm going to get in on the shop today, but we'll work on the lettering. Okay, the first thing I want to do, get me a nice new scalpel blade. Get the table clean. Remember the old trick, we're going to work on the bottom first. We're going to try to get the bottom as close to being finished as we can before we move on. And the first step is we want to lay out the box, the actual box that we're going to need to do the lettering in. And what I do is I'll leave about, I'll make it exactly an eighth of an inch from the hinge line. That'll make that nice and easy to work on. Make it easy to keep symmetrical too. This is actually going to be the box that we're going to use to do the lettering in. And I'll put an eighth of an inch stripe. In fact, I'll give myself an extra eighth of an inch up top here. So we're actually going to make a box to work in. Give myself an eighth of an inch of clearance here. Okay, now I want to decide, do I want to make 90 degree letters? And if I do, where's my little pen? I have to start dividing up. And what I do in this case is I'll add up the space available. I actually could get the last letter to come out right about here if I wanted to. And I actually could start the first letter here. Let's see how many square inches we have to work with here. And of course you can calculate this out on a piece of paper. You don't have to actually use the wing. We have 16 inches to work with here. 16 total inches. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to lay out the first piece of tape here. Make sure I've got this 90 degrees to lay this out. Could be a little bit more this way. Because this is going to set up all the boxes. Okay, and do the same thing over here, make sure I have a 90 degree. I'm using a T-square right off the trailing edge. Now this now actually constitutes the box in which we can do the lettering on the wing. Now one of the ways I get just a rough estimate of exactly how many letters I'm going to need. I know I need 8 letters. One is a very thin letter, an I. So I just take and fold an IBM card to what I think is roughly the size of the letter, and then I'll space it out this way. C-A-R-D, full space, I-N-A-L. Okay, it needs to be a little bit thinner, so what I do now is I fold it down another, maybe 3/16 of an inch. And this lets me, I'm using this like a divider. If you were a mechanical computer type of person, you would just feed in the numbers and say, well, there's the numbers. But because I'm a seat of the pants, C, A, R, D, space for the I, N, A, L. Okay, so this is a little too short and that's a little too long. So now I'm going to cut this paper. Well, first I'll measure it. And I know that the width of the letters should be 1 7/8". 1 7/8" will give me just about what I want. So I'll make up a little pattern 1 7/8". Now I know if I make the letters this this width, they're too big, and this I have space left over, so what I'll do is I'll try to cut this right in the middle. And again, this is just to rough it out. Now you can see what I've done. I just cut a little hole, put a little piece of tape on it, and I just can lay my pattern out now. Get it parallel. That kind of holds it in place. I'll lay out the next piece of tape, and this is just a rough spacing. Now, if you decide you want to make the letters a little bit bigger, smaller, thinner, you just change the shape of this paper. Figuring out how to lay this out is three quarters of the problem. Once you actually see how this is done, you can go and lay out lettering very rapidly. And each plane then is unique. You don't have that decal look. You don't have that look like, oh my God, it looks just like Midgley's plane. Oh my God, it looks just C-A-R-D. So I need four big ones. Then I have to determine, because the I will be the thickness of other letters, I have to determine how thick the I will be. So I'll lay out the first four. Now I have to determine the thickness of the letters. Now what you can do is just strictly do this by eye. You can lay out a piece of, in this case I'm using up old IBM cards, make it a little bit extra thick to begin with, and then just kind of look at, well, is that going to look too fat, too thin? Because you have to envision the eighth inch stripe around it also. Trying to look at a picture on the wall there and see just the look and the spacing that I wanted. Okay, that's just about it. So now I know this is the thickness of the eye. This will make it real easy. Now once I lay out all the tape, if I'm not happy with it, hey, it's not a problem. I should really put a little hole in here and have some tape hold it on, but right now I can just mark it. Now I can go back. I can lay out the other three here. Now at this point in time, what you really have is a series of parallel boxes, and they're put on the wing in a way that you hope is going to give you the look that you want. And now what you need to do is within each box is lay out the lettering in eighth inch tape. Then when we're all done laying out the lettering, it's a simple matter to mask off everything that isn't a letter and spray it. When we pull up the tape, each letter is going to have a nice silver outline around it, and so that'll be one really nice exotic looking feature of this lettering. We should be able to make some really nice lettering, whatever color we decide as the final color, but laying out in boxes like this and then working each letter within each box, that's the whole trick toward getting it. Okay, now you can see what I did as a little test. I tried to fine line tape. I wasn't really crazy about the fine line tape. It's all straight lines, and I just lay out the shape of the lettering. I'm using this as a template for my thickness. little holes so it stays in place, and I can just mask right around it. And this way I get to do a custom set of lettering that really will fit right into the area that we need. Now this is where you start to do your little experiments and fine tuning. Notice I laid the first letter out with the fine line tape, didn't care for that at all. Went to the masking tape, that's a little bit better. And as I work one letter off, now what I need is the silver outline of the letter. I don't need any of these trim borders. So one by one, as I go down the letters and I lay each one out, I check the thickness of the letter, and I just check the thickness with that little, what is that little gauge? Just use that as a gauge and lay out the letter in whatever fashion you want. Now we're just going to go right down now and lay out the rest of the letters and then take a look at it and see how we like it. Pull off all the borders before we put clear on the tape. Once we put clear on the tape, we're kind of semi-committed to the thing. But the fine tuning here, when we're finished, we'll take a look at it. And this is the whole idea of fine tuning it, is you get to take a look at it and say, yeah, I like that. Oh, I don't like that. Oh, it's a little too big, a little too small, or whatever it is. You don't have to, right now, we could pull this all off and go put Letrosets on a plane if we wanted to. But have a little bit of patience and lay out a couple of different styles of letters here or whatever. Like for instance, I want to clip the end of the A just to kind of customize a few of the letters. And if you look up at the old Vision, I did the same thing on the N on the Vision. Just kind of on the G's had a cute little curl on them. Just get some ideas. You can lay this out. We'll probably spend the better part of tomorrow, since it's getting late tonight, better part of tomorrow just fooling with this. Lay out one side, get it exactly how we want it, and then, you know, let's hope if we like it, we'll flip it over and do the same thing. Now, if when we're all finished, for instance, we say, oh, too big. Well, what we'll do is trim down take an eighth inch off the templates, and nobody will know. You won't know that the lettering on the bottom is bigger than the top. This is why you always do the bottom first. It's just to get a little feel, get used to using the razor blades. Spend a little time just getting your little technique and your little fingertips ready to work. Okay, we're working on a D right now, working our way up the lettering scale here. One by one, we remove the stripes and the outlines. And what's left is just the letter, in tape and spaced. I would even rip. What do you say? Boy, what's bothering them about that system? We'll make a real exotic scoop. If you put a 427 Ford in a Falcon, what you do is make a fancy hood scoop. He should be able to do that. But real close to it. Hope he's gonna. Okay, we have the full lettering outlined in eighth inch tape now. on one wing. And since it's getting late tonight, what I'm going to try to do is press this tape down now and outline both sides with clear, so I get the tape sealed under both edges. So I'm going to try to get that done before I leave tonight. Time is sneaking up on me here. What time is it? Oh my God. Oh, Karen is going to die. It's almost 2:00 in the morning. She's going to, oh, you'll see me tomorrow. I'll have a cast on one arm and a patch on one eye. Anyway, we're going to try to finish this one side of the lettering tonight if we can. Now, exactly the same way we did the trim, you want to get a coat of clear on everything. This is going to dry overnight because we're going to be out of here real soon. I'm not going to get a chance to do too much more tonight. You want to get a coat, at least one coat of clear around both sides, both edges of this tape. Now, tomorrow or the next day we do get to work on this, what we're going to try to do is we're going to mask off everything except the inside of the lettering and do the lettering, and we'll mix up the paint for that. Haven't really decided if I want to do gold microflake or what. We'll make a decision on that tonight. We really have a couple days to make the decision. But anyway, you want to go around all the edges here, just this, exactly the same way we did on a trim. That's why I kind of detailed it in on the trim video. If you haven't seen the trim video, that's the one before this. Kind of details out all the little techniques that we're going to use. Now, when we put the tape on to mask this, when you pull up the tape to mask it, you have to be kind of really careful that you don't pull up this eighth inch tape, because once we seal it, remember what we're trying to do here is not have any more than one coat of paint anywhere on the airplane. One of the things we're trying to do anyway. That and hit the lottery. Alright, so rather than get in too involved in this, I'll do the rest of this off camera. Both sides of the tape have to get sealed. And if I do have any more time, I'll start the other wing. Now, believe it or not, yesterday we lost the whole day. We had a pipe burst over at the house here. We had to work on the house the whole day. So what's happened is the tape that's been on this stripe. Now, let me get the phone. Now, as I just started saying a little while ago, things were crazy here yesterday. Had a pipe burst behind a wall of the house. Had to rip a wall down. John DeTavio's coming over here today to replace my kitchen floor, so I'm not going to work on this much. But I want to use this opportunity, this is a great opportunity in fact, to mention a few things that might or might not happen to you somewhere in the course of doing one of these jobs. Now, the other day, before we got involved with this house busting up, we did manage to lay out the one side of the lettering, and we did manage to go around the edges with clear, and that's where we left this. And we did manage to get the white stripe on in the tape. So now you come into the shop today and you have to kind of make a decision. Now, I'm only going to have about 2 hours to work on this today, three to most. So I know I'm not going to get the other side of the lettering laid out realistically. So I'll spend the time, pull up all the tape off the white stripes. And this is what I want to mention. There's two things you don't want to do with tape on an airplane. You don't want to put it on and then leave it on for 3 weeks. If you do that, that's asking for trouble. That glue just keeps getting stickier and stickier and stickier, and it turns into Imron and then into hot stuff, and then pretty soon you'll be pulling the ribs out of the wing. But you never want to pull the tape off before 24 hours. So what happens if you get to a point in time, which is what just happened to me now, and this is why I'm sharing it with you, you get to a point now where, I can't finish this side, so I'm stuck. And I really can't mask this off and paint the trim. I'm kind of at a little bit of a problem here. Well, at least get the tape off. At least I'll get the striping tape off. I'll get the white stripe exposed, scrape it with the credit card. And at least now the only thing I'm leaving on the plane for an extra day is the word Cardinal. I wouldn't want to leave this on the plane you know, for 2 weeks or something like that. And that's why it's, I'm taking a minute out of this video to mention that one of the biggest problems you have with doing intricate trim jobs is the tape stays on the plane too long. You have to do like a little time planning thing. My plan would have worked well had I been able to do Thursday and Friday work on a plane all day. I would have had the other side masked off, the top, spray all the lettering, and pull it off before the weekend. I would have even made a special trip to the house on Saturday to pull off the tape. But very, very important to remember, tape stays on 24 hours, but try not to let it stay on 25 hours. That's always a good general rule of thumb when you're doing lacquer. Now we'll pull this up right now. You know, and just another quick thought, you know, everybody has a personal life they have to work around. You know, if we all had our personal lives in order, well, this would all be so easy. But we have to work around other commitments. And today this is really putting me to the test because I really wanted to get the rest of this lettering on, but as it is, I try to use the time productively, and that's about all I can do right now, is try to maximize the amount I can get done today. And I'm going to do this exactly the way I just want to show this one little thing once I get all the tape off. Once you get the white stripe up, then you have to go over it with the card again anytime you're doing multiple stripes. And what I like to do now, see, that's what I didn't want to do. Anytime you get a little spot where the paint peels up, where you get a little chip out of the paint or whatever, well, that's why you have those jars sitting over there with the paint already in them, ready to go. You can just dig right in. You don't have a problem. You don't have to go open up a jar, put a brush in it. And as that paint gets thicker and thicker, you leave it open for a weekend, of course, it'll get real thick. Well, just add a few drops of thinner until it's back to where you can put a 6-inch brush stroke down. But that time management thing, I've glossed over it a few times. Managing your time efficiently is really some kind of major part of it, especially when it comes flying time and you need to get practice in. And you find out, well, you got to work around your work schedule, which I have to do. Have to work around two work schedules, in fact. If you want to maximize the amount of time you have and get the most for your money, you really need to put some thought into it. Get out the old Visa card. Now, while you have this shaved down like this, this is an excellent time. Look around, any little spots are missing or need to be touched up. And I see right here I need to touch up a spot. Well, on an ongoing basis, touch it up. Don't wait until the whole plane is finished to touch it up. As you go around, touch it up. Right, so we'll just go around the plane off camera, do the rest of this. We expect John in here with the Griffin. He's going to be bringing in the Griffin so we can do some work on the nose of that, and we'll pull off. I guess the only thing we're going to get to do today is pull off the rest of the tape. But still, it's better than getting nothing done. Still, even this is one step ahead. Now, while we're waiting for John here, we did get all the tape off the striping. Knocked down all the edges. And we expect John within the hour, so we'll just hang out here and wait for the guy, wait for the man. Now see, this is a way of using time, and this is probably a very significant thing if you count the overall package of what's going on, is use the time. Now we could have taken this hour this morning and maybe laid out some of the tape and We want to try to lay it out in such a way that we're going to shoot the canopy and the lettering at the same time. Then we only have to put the metal flake paint, the micro flake, I should say, in the gun once. If we put, and believe me, it's a pain in the neck when you see how much work goes into this micro flake stuff. It's a nuisance. It ruins the gun. You breathe it in. It's terrible stuff to work with, but it really does look nice. But we want to try to set this up, and probably within the next two sessions, we will get the lettering masked off in the canopy, and we can shoot it all in one session. Now we're just waiting for John. We'll try to lay out some of this. Now, because I have one less letter on this side, I want to space this in just a little bit. Now let's lay out the spacing and see how this works. In the time we're waiting for old John D. John D. is always late, by the way. He has never been on time for anything in his life. I guess it took us about an hour. We got that all blocked out, so. Now I'm going to get out a little bit of clear. Take care of this right now. Put the clear around the edges, and maybe I'll even get to do the top of the wing by the time this guy gets here. Unbelievable. Mr. John Late DeTavio. What a guy. Now here's a little tip. This jar has been sitting open for two full days, and it seems like the paint is a little bit thick. When I can't lay on a nice edge, by the way, one good way to lay out these edges is do the outside first, go around the whole perimeter, and then do the inside. But when the dope won't flow on and give you a complete stripe in one stroke of the pen, when it runs out of dope halfway through a stroke, halfway through a letter, a couple of drops of thinners take care of that right away. Well, finally, DeTavio arrives. He dropped off the Griffin. Did the work in the kitchen. I got about another 2 hours left here tonight. I want to try to tape off the top of the plane. And there's that little emblem I was describing earlier on, somewhere on in a video. Little Griffon. Anyway, another exotic lettering job. Well, I just started up here, and this is pretty much going to be a redundancy of what we did on the bottom. No sense just using up tape here. We'll finish this off, and we might even get this finished off tonight, depending on how many times the phone rings. As I say that, the phone rings. Okay, one panel down. One to go. We really may really get to do this tonight. Okay, we're ready to do the masking, and we're going to try this technique that using aluminum foil instead of newsprint. Just a couple of things. Newsprint, you don't want anywhere near an airplane. Newsprint is death. The ink will rub off on a silver or the white or whatever. Second choice, if you don't want to use tin foil, is good quality magazines like Playboy, Penthouse, Busty, Hustler, any of the good magazines that come on quality paper. You sure as heck don't want to use Model Aviation or anything. You know, you want a quality magazine. You want something that the paint's not going to bleed through. Newspapers, Gonzo. I've even tried using paper towels, not really good. And of course, you always have to seal all the edges and all the staple holes. So what we're going to try today is we're going to try doing this, and of course, this is a tip we've gotten from Walt Prey. We're going to try using Walt's method of using tinfoil, and let's see how it works out. Now what I'm using is a very low stick tape. This is Frost King tape. It has very little stick. Rub it on a flannel shirt once. Rub it on the edge. You want to leave the minimum amount of tape sticking out, an eighth to a quarter of an inch max. And just go over and we'll just block this out right to the very edge. Now remember, we're just going to be airbrushing letters, so this really isn't an ultra critical thing. And you can always let it overlap. And needless to say, you can use the cheapest foil. This is what the Food Town brand. The cheapest brand is just fine. Already is how nice it conforms to everything. So this may be just another one of those little tips that people are sharing, and we just, of course, at the way you can share it with a lot of people. If you have a great little tip, come on, send it in. Come on, you can do it. Share that information. One of those big mysteries of people that pull the paint right off the plane with the tape, that's part of the reason. The old flannel shirt trick. Just another tip from Pro Stunt Products. Now I'm sure if you're a real cheapskate like Stifel or somebody, you can use the tin foil over and over again. I don't know that we'll have to use it over and over again, but now keep in mind, before this has ever touched the paint on the airplane, it's been rubbed on my shirt and this material here. So it's really, a lot of the stickiness is out of the tape. Another advantage of this is there'll never be any bleed through like there is with paper. You'll always get spots where the paper will get wet and bleed right through. Just show this up to this point. Now, of course, what we have to do is fill in all the little areas in between. In here with masking tape that's had the stickiness taken off of it too, and in here we'll just use some wide tape. You do that piece by piece, take the stickiness off the tape as you do it.
just give you some idea of one way you can get the masking done relatively quickly. Again, on a future video, we're going to document the method where you use rubber cement and Xerox paper, so if you're not crazy about this method, somewhere in the near future you'll see that method. That way certainly has its merits, and its good side and bad side, like everything else. I just try to fill in as many of the big areas as I can. And you can just cut randomly right down the center of the tape. You don't have to be too fancy about this. You do your stencil out of contact paper, of course. You have a little more work to do in preparing the mat, but ultimately you wind up with the same thing, where the only thing showing is the numbers.
Okay, we have one little panel, and obviously you can use up all little pieces of tape here. I just keep cutting right on the 1/8 tape. Press all the edges down and go on to the next panel. Just remember to get all the stickiness you can off of the tape. You don't need a lot of stickiness for this. Whenever you don't have an edge involved, you don't need a lot of stickiness. And you don't care how sloppy it is once it goes off the edge. It doesn't have to be too neat. Unless you're going to go to appearance judging with the tape still on the plane, which I don't think you will. Even I don't do that. Even a Bhagwan doesn't do that. Seems like that's one of the things a lot of people spend a lot of time is backmasking a plane. Once you do, you'll notice I'm doing the bottom first again. Once you get a little feel for it, it goes pretty quick. You can use up all scrap tape that's already been pressed down. Now I want to talk a little bit while we're masking this off about, I'm going to use what's known as Ditzler Micro Flake. It's a form of metal flake. It's very small flakes. I'm going to mix it with Siglite coat, and I'm going to run a little test on the bottom of the plane to see if I'm happy with the way it looks. Now if I'm not, I want to save the top for last, but I'll always do the bottom again first. Any kind of little experiment you can run on the bottom will always be better than if you do it on the top. And again, it's made by Ditzler. It's called Micro Flake. You add it to clear paint, and it looks the equivalent of Metal Flake. It makes excellent lettering. It makes really brilliant, bright lettering. And it's funny, Casmanato a couple of years ago wrote me a letter and wanted to know where I got my Micro Flake and where do I do Micro Flake, and I sent him all the information. In fact, I sent him my Micro Flake. And we got down to, this is in 1990, we got down to the appearance judging, and he had a beautiful job. And I think part of the reason he won a concourse that year was the flakes, the beautiful flake job he did. Whoops, come off. So, it's just one more way you can add a little sparkle to a plane, add a little pizzazz, whatever you want to call it. Once you get going on this, and you can see right through the tape, this is the Frost King tape, the real unsticky stuff. Needless to say, after you're all done, press down all the edges a little bit. We already have a coat of clear on everything, so as soon as we finish the masking job, we're going to mix up the paint. And what we want to have is, Microflake comes in two colors, silver and gold. We want to have gold lettering and a silver canopy, the flakes on a canopy silver. So we're going to have to mix up two batches of paint. And believe me, there's easier ways of doing lettering than this. This is a very labor-intensive way of doing it, but what it allows you is to actually see the lettering in place on a plane before you actually make a commitment and paint it on. When you make up a mask, like with the Xerox rubber cement method, and we will show that, when you use that method, once you put it on, you really can't see it in place. And so you never really know what you're buying, a dead fish or a dead cow or what, until you're finished. Alright, this completes one section, and it gives you just an idea of how much time. We're not going to show the other side, of course. That's what's involved in masking off one side of the plane. Now, I really have to say, this method does really speed up a bit the process of backmasking out the plane. I'll make sure I thank Walt again for this one. Walt's supposed to be building a Cardinal right now, so maybe we can help him out some way. I wonder if we can find anything to do for him. This is a great tip.
almost ready to spray. We'll be ready to spray in 5 minutes here. We just have to do the letters still. Now, even if a little bit does bleed through, it's not the end of the world. Believe me, you don't have to go crazy sealing up every edge. We're going to be spraying with 30 pounds of pressure. Try to put it on dry so a lot of it doesn't bleed down under the lettering. Okay, the four products we can actually add to the paint here are the PPG Micro Sequin Flakes, the silver, Micro Sequin Flakes Gold, Limco Diamond Flake Silver Dust, Gold Powder. Now be aware, any metal flakes, metal, whatever you want to call it, diamond flakes, metal flakes, micro flakes, come in various sizes. So if you just go to a body shop supply store, don't just buy any metal flakes. Some of them come too big to put in a gun. These work fine. The PPG Micro Sequin Flakes work fine. Stuff is relatively expensive. The gold powder is very expensive. Okay, now what I did, I mixed up a little bit of clear light coat. Have the gold. It takes very little powder. You really don't need a lot of this stuff. And you gotta constantly shake this now when you're gonna use it. Constantly shake it while it's in suspension, or it comes out of suspension, it'll all sink to the bottom. And always run a little test before you go over to the plane. Again, we paint the bottom first, needless to say. So we're kind of ready for action here, I guess is the right word. Always start with a little bit less than you think you need, because this stuff really does build up. Now another thing too, just to keep in mind here, when you spray this in a gun, forever and all time and forever, this gun will be a metal flake gun. Don't go putting this in your clear gun or you'll never get it out. Always a month later, a little poo and a little bit of metal flake comes out. You need an old gun and you need to keep it just for flake. Don't mix and match guns. This is an old beat up gun and this is the one we use just for this purpose. As soon as you're finished with this, you spray a quart or so of thinner through it. That'll get most of the flake out. You'll notice if you breathe the air in from this, you're going to blow your nose a week later. And there it is, gold micro flake. These things get everywhere. It's unbelievable. If you have air heat in the house, they'll get everywhere. The cat will be sneezing micro flake. You look in a toilet, there'll be micro flake. This stuff is unbelievable. If you've never used it before, it gets everywhere. So preferably when you spray it, now we're in a confined area here, and we're going to be spraying. It's getting late anyway. It's too late to even mention. Karen will be mad if she knows I'm this late. But we're going to spray this inside tonight because it's such a small area. But if, say, if you are spraying much more than this for an area, you definitely want to do this outside. Otherwise, your whole shop, your phone,
every electrical outlet, every light bulb is going to be covered with microflake. So anyway, let's get ready to spray. 30 PSI to start. We'll run a little test and see how this stuff looks coming out of the can. Okay, after one coat, that's what it looks like. Now, typically it takes about three full coats to get the full effect of the metal flake. Before you see all the sparkles and everything, you have to get clear on it too. So what I'll do is I'll let this dry about 20 minutes, then I'll go on, give it the second coat. I can do the other wing panel while we're waiting, in fact. Can be pretty disappointing if you think this stuff covers. You really don't be disappointed until you get at least two or three coats on. Put it down there because one side, I want one side to dry and the other side to, I don't want to be touching it when it's drying. And that's about five coats on the canopy. The silver doesn't seem to cover as good as the gold. Three coats on the gold lettering and five coats on the canopy, and I'm spacing them out about a half hour or so apart. And of course trying to defumigate the place as best I can, even though that's not working. Another trick, if you do spray in a house and you have to spray in a house, run a shop vac. The shop vac seems to suck a lot of the stuff out of the air, the metal flake particles and the dust and everything. I've been running a shop vac when the camera's not on just to keep it a little bit bearable, really. Anyway, we'll let this dry, we'll give it a couple more coats off camera and come back to it later. What I'm doing, I'm just fogging the edge of the canopy, because I want this all to dry up at the same time. Just give it an outline of candy apple green.
Then now the trick is put it aside to dry for a day. Don't touch it. I want to show you something really beautiful here. Everything in the whole shop is covered with metal flake now. Take a little walk out to the table here, and if you look at the macro lens, every single thing in this shop is now metal flake. See, there's flakes on here. Let's go over to the radio. Flakes on the radio. There's flakes on the tapes. There's flakes everywhere. Everywhere you look. So, just be aware, you're breathing this stuff in. You're going to have microflakes here, microflakes everywhere. The whole place is microflakes. Anyway, we're going to put this aside to dry for today. Come back and work on it tomorrow. And air out, most of all, air out the shop and the house here. That's definitely it for today. That's enough microflake for a long time. Well, we vacuumed up the shop, spent about an hour cleaning up the microflakes off of everything. I'm real happy with the way the tin foil worked out. I would say everybody should give that a try. The microflakes are sitting here drying, and we have a weekend of working on a dollhouse coming up. So we'll be back to this in 2 days. That should be all nice and dry, and we'll give it the best shot at pulling off the tape. And what I want to say here is, you know, again, this is, I really busted my rear end today, trying to make a point here, really busted my rear end today so that this could be drying over the weekend, because this will allow me to start working on actually painting and trimming. Okay, today we come into the shop. I pulled off all the tape very, very carefully. Oh, gotta get the phone. Another important call from Elvis. He wanted to know how my the tweener's coming out. Anyway, we pulled off all the tin foil and pulled off all the tape very, very slow and carefully. And we've shown that on the video already many times. Don't want to go back and redundantly do that. But I do want to pass out a few little tips. Now, just for a reality check, and believe me, right here, a little bit of the tape peeled up. I have one spot on the plane where the silver peeled up, one spot the size of a pencil eraser, so we're going to start filling that in and building it up. When I go to shoot the purple here, I'll shoot a little silver over that with the spray gun. Now, what I did, a couple of things here. You'll see little bubbles, and I'll try to zero in with the macro lens here. This is a little bubble when you pull up the tape. And by the way, I want to pass this tip on to you. That roll of tape I used, that frost tape that wasn't so sticky, I had to leave it on the plane overnight because I had some work to do here at the house. And it was a mistake. I'm going to go back to using all 3M tape. I tried to use that because the guy that sold it to me told me it was very good. Won't mention his name, but it's not good. Go back to using all 3M body shop tape. Skip the frost-free tape. Anyway, these little bubbles, these will go away when you put the next coat of paint on. But now you have to be aware, you've just pulled up the finish from the wood, and it's delicate. Now a couple little spots back here. This is one where it started pulling up, so you can get rid of these little corners of flake and stuff too. Now I did pull up the tape here, so what it's telling me is in this little quadrant here, I don't have good adhesion for whatever reason. Whether that paint never really dried out the way it should, but that's the only bad one on the rest of the plane. The rest of them look pretty decent anyway. And there was one kind of a little spot up here on the striping on right around here I didn't really like. I'll touch that up. Now I'm going to take about an hour right now. I'm going to take an hour and a half. I won't bother putting it on camera because it's redundant. And I'm going to touch up. I'm going to go around each edge, press down. By the way, another nice tip. The old, what is it? WD-40, yeah. That's late at night. Oh God, I hate working late at night. The M600. Okay, the M600 will take these little spots of glue. When I pulled up the tape, there was some little glue stayed here, little glue, because of that frost tape, that Frost King tape or whatever it was. And believe me, that was not a good tip. I'm not gonna ever put that on a video again. But you know, I want to show this is a reality check. I want to show this is what really happens when you experiment and when you try things, new things, when you're kind of a nuclear scientist or whatever. You it isn't all cut and dry. It isn't all like,
you might be led to believe by some people that, oh, I never have mistakes. Oh, nothing ever was wrong for me. I just crank out these beautiful planes one right after another. You can bet your life Steve Busso and Ski and whoever and Fancher have all had problems with fillets, all had problems with different things, especially when you're trying new paint, new techniques. Now, one of the things I have just done because of that metal flake, and I showed again, I'll go back. If you go right here on a table, you can see there's little metal flakes everywhere. So I went down, I wiped the whole plane off very, very carefully with the M600 and a paper towel, and that seems to clean it up real well. That's one of the good things, to get the all of the little flakes off the plane. If you spray on the M600, you can just go right, this will clean off all the loose flake too. And I would say at this point in time, I'd be taking some M600, getting all the little tiny flakes off the whole plane, clean the whole thing up. Anywhere that leaves that little tape residue, the M600 takes it right off. So the lesson to be learned from today is go with all 3M tape. Then I'm going to finish up this video, put a few pictures on the end. The next tape, we're going to start actually spraying the trim on the plane. We're kind of satisfied the way this came out. There's a couple little spots we have to touch up. But that's all part of the game. And so we'll finish this tape out with a few photographs. And look forward to seeing you on the next tape and starting the trim on this guy. Now we'll close out this video just to show some of the pictures from the old albums here. Here's an old picture of Bill Rich at this, this is at the Johnsville contest. Notice how many stunners are in this row. A great day, I guess it wasn't a great day for Bill. This was the day he got to fly to Killer Bee. Working his way up, Mr. Tough Guy. Love this guy. Another little picture of the cowling, the air outlet scoops on the MiG. Nice cowling job. Here's the old side view of Relentless. Boy, that was a good plane. One of my favorites. Now talk about concourse winners. Look at the lettering on this. Candy apple blue lettering. The way Ski did this trim, he painted the plane black and then did candy apple blue over black. And this is candy apple blue over silver. That's the lace maker. Believe me, if you've never seen this plane in real life, this is my vote for the plane of all time. The lace maker, Ski Dombrowski. Scott Richland with one of his original Banshees. And this guy has really come a long way in the last few years. Scott Richland of Virginia. Nice story here. Scott is the one that, when I was doing a newsletter, made me the Pro Stunt Alligator. He made a mold for a fiberglass alligator and sent me Pro Stunt Alligators. Scott, you're okay. I don't care what your wife says about you. One of the truly, truly professional people in the world of stunt, Craig Gunder. He's very intense. This is back in his early days with the Tudor. And I can't tell you how intense this guy is now. He is definitely going to be one of the champions of the future. Another old picture of Relentless out on the deck. Boy, you go through these old albums, I'll tell you, the memories in these albums could make you sick. Just unbelievable how many good and bad memories we have of the old days. Picture of Billy Suarez in younger days giving me a launch. Good old Bill, back in the hobby. You'll never get out again. You're in for life, kid. You'll never get out. A true artist, a true craftsman, Bill Suarez. One of the classic, my classic, or always classic planes of all time. This is Louisiana Lightning, one of the BJLJ Big Jim designs. This plane was 61 ounces, 750 square inches of wing. Absolutely great performer. Craig Gunder flew it for a year. John DeTavio flew it for a year. Jeff Stifel flew it for a year, and I flew it for a year. Absolutely a world-class plane. One of the best I've ever had. Louisiana Lightning.
And this was back when we were originally testing and developing the Super Tiger 60 with Big Jim. This is a no cowling nose. Notice there's no cowling. We did several this way. They all turned out to be pretty competitive. Another view of the no cowl nose here. And a picture of Big Jim. We'll close this tape out with a picture of Big Jim. The legend of stunt. If anybody out there thinks there's somebody in the world or on the planet that knows more about stunt motors than this man, or about eating watermelon, I don't know. This guy is great, believe me. And if you've never talked to him on the phone, give him a call. 718-529-4631. Reverse the charges. He's rich. He's a millionaire. He's a taxi driver. He's a watermelon. Who knows what he is? Anyway, my best friend, my partner, my protege, my whatever. I don't know what I could call him. I don't even know what to say about this guy. Without him, I'd probably be back in bike racing and making $10,000 a year racing bikes. Anyway, Jim, we love you. We're saying goodbye on this video. And let's hope all your crashes will be...